our learning council for recording on outer perusal of the record, we find that as body number one was appointed in the institution on the post of clerk in the year 1983 on consolidated monthly salary. The appointment was made for a period of 1 year of probation. Whereas body number one was appointed on an application moved by him on 15/7/1983. It is apparent from the appointment letter dated 29/8/1983 that the post in question was not advertised nor any selection committee was constituted for appointment. Respondent number one, Rakesh Kumar Gupta, was appointed by the management on the application given by him, as there were no rules for appointment on the post of clerk in the institution. The rules 1984 came into force with effect from 1985 with prospective effect. No retrospective effects can be given to the said rules, and hence the same would have no effect on the appointment made on 29/8/1983. So far as the termination of services of respondent number one is concerned, no prior approval was required from the district basic education officer Moradabad for the reason that services were not governed by the rules 1984. Moreover, respondent number one was never confirmed on the post of clerk. He was on probation from August 1983 till November 1985 when his services were terminated by the management. We also find it relevant to note that respondent number one did not raise any grievance from November 1985 till the year 1999, nor he was ever reinstated in the year 99 when the institution came in grant in aid of the state government. The respondent number one woke up from deep slumber and moved an application on 30/3/99 for his retirement. The district basic education officer Moradabad heard in law directing the reinstatement of the respondent number one widely ordered in 1999. The district basic education officer Moradabad has no authority in law to direct the management of law to permit the respondent number one to resume his duty, as he had remained out of service for a period of about 14 years. The lack of any valid explanation for this long delay shows that respondent number one had abandoned his services. We find in the above comments that the state government exercises control over the chairperson and its members, and hence they are under the state government. He also submits that the state human rights chairperson being under the direct control of the state government in respect of his appointments, terms and conditions including salaries and allowances, amounts to our employment under the state government. He therefore submits that this clearly attracts the intelligibility clause of the 1985 Act referred to herein before. And consequently, this legal defect cannot sustain the impugned appointment of the chairperson. We fondly ask further urge that it is the intention of the legislature and such similar provisions contained in other laws that should be taken into consideration to reconstitute the opposite provision attracting the ineligibility as pointed out above. Through another supplementary affidavit, he has invited the attention of the court to Article 319 of the Constitution of India, which also entails such ineligibility for the chairman of the Union Public Service Commission. The provisions of the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India Act 2014 in respect of the chairperson of the said authority and provisions of Section 5 of the Uttar Pradesh Lokayukt and Up Lokayukt Act 1975 to contend that there are such similar disqualifications that have been prescribed, and consequently the same principles should be applied to constitute that the appointment of a chairperson of the state human rights commission should be treated to be an employment under the state government. Sri Vijay Bahadur Singh, learned advocate general, on the other hand, has urged that the constitution of the commission under Section 21 of the 93 Act and the appointment under Section 22 would leave no room for doubt that it is the state government which constitutes the commission, and the consequential act of appointment follows after recommendation is made by the committee as defined under Subsection 1 of Section 22 of the Act. His Excellency, the governor, then under his warrant and C, issues the letter of appointment. This is not an employment as understood in service jurisprudence as that of a master and servant, or even in terms of employer and employee relationship. He contends that once a chairperson is installed in office, his removal is only by His Excellency the President of India after an inquiry to the Supreme Court. The state government therefore does not exercise any such control in relation to the removal of a chairperson who can otherwise himself resign from his office. Salaries and allowances which are payable on the terms and conditions of service are in order to facilitate the functioning of the chairperson as the chairman of the State Human Rights Commission. The Human Rights Commission is a body to conduct and supervise all inquiries relating to human rights violations which is not subject to any control or supervision by the state government. And he has substantiated his arguments by contending that this appointment of a chairperson is not under the state government but is under the 93 Act. The Council for the Petitioner contended that the order of allowing the election petition of respondent number 4 was based on three grounds. The first main ground was that pro forma 4 relating to said election was not applicable. His contention is that said document relating to form 4 was not applicable because it was present with sealed ballot papers and was not called for bill. His submission was that second ground of passing impute order was that the alleged arithmetical error in counting of voters in this regard. He has submitted that there appears arithmetical error of one count in counting of votes, but this will not affect the result because in Form 4 and Form 6 relating to said elections, the total number of valid and invalid votes were specifically mentioned. Since Form 4 is prepared on the basis of Form 6 and Form 7, therefore this arithmetical error can be rectified by calculation. And in fact, no error was submitted when result of said election was declared. His further submission is that in spite of filing of written statements, the prescribed authority had found it technically erroneous and had not accepted its readings, although there was no error in said written statements, which is in accordance with law and procedure, and such pleading should not be discarded at the time of judgment. On the basis of these contentious learned counsel qualifications paid for quashing of the issued order of recounting of ballot papers. These submissions were reputed by Sri Ajit Singh, Senior Counsel for Respondent Number 4, who submitted that written statement of the petitioner was not discarded by the prescribed authority. On the other hand, it was conceded. He further submitted that in due notice, but after appreciating the facts and evidences and after application of judicial mind, in which all relevant points, including arithmetical error, was also conceded. His submission was that in this particular matter, admittedly, there was arithmetical error of one vote, and the difference of votes of petitioner and of respondent number 4 was also only one vote. Having heard the learned counsel for the parties, the court finds that the directions given by the learned single judge is in consonance with the policy framed by the Mandi Committee. A perusal of the policy indicates that priority was to be given to those students who had no jobs allotted to them and who were paying the Mandi fee. Clause 1 of the scheme indicates that lists would be prepared from those eligible students who had no job allotted in their name and who were paying Mandi fee. Clause 1 indicated that the list would be prepared in the descending order, namely that the trader who was paying the highest Mandi fee would be placed at serial number 1, and a person paying a lower Mandi fee would come at serial number 2, and so forth. In the light of this provision, the learned Sikandjas found that there were 149 applicants and that the total number of shops constructed was 74 in number. The learned single judge accordingly directed that the Mandi Committee would prepare a list of those applicants who do not have a shop in the market yard, either in the initial name or even as a partner of a firm. Such direction in our view is in consonance with the scheme framed by the Mandi Samiti, namely that the shops would be allotted to those traders who do not have a shop. The contention of the Learning Council for the appellant in Special Appeal Number 272 of 2009 is consequently bereft of merit. At this stage, the contention of the Learning Council for the appellant that the Mandi Samiti has itself certified that the appellant do not have a shop and have arbitrarily been ousted from the list and therefore a direction should be issued is also bereft of merit. Such information was before the learned single judge, nor such documents could be considered in the appeal. The summation of the learned council for the appellant is that there was no error apparent on the face of the record and consequently the order could not be reviewed by the learned single judge is patently bereft of merit. He further submits that earlier order directing the shop to be allocated by draw of lots was in consequence with clause 6 of the scheme is wholly erroneous and is conceived. From a combined reading of clauses 1 and 6 of the scheme, it is clear that the list of eligible candidates who do not have a shop in the market yard was to be prepared in the descending order. In the instant case, a befitting candidate as against the nature of the post and its responsibilities will have to be assessed accordingly. This would be an individual capability assessment without comparing it with anybody higher or lower in merit. The scrutiny should be like an athlete in good form who need not be compared with a champion. The accomplishments of a fit candidate that reflects a perception of his being suited to occupy the post should be the ground for consideration within the parameters as ingrained in the rules. A personality like that of a good tailored suit, not necessarily of the best dress material or designer tailored, can be termed as a fit personality, presentable enough, commensurate to the post. Unfitness lies in the incapability of a person to submit to the occasion, and one who is not possessed of the basic talents to hold the post to be judged, of course, within the parameters prescribed and not through seer calculations. Lack or want of fitness would be something like unripe, unhardened, or someone unbecoming. Fitness in the context of the present rule would be the minimum required level of fitness about which the appointing authority has not framed any parameters and has drawn the merit on the basis of maximum marks. The authority therefore has put aside seniority, showing it the minimum respect on the altar of maximum merit. The intention of the rule can be gathered from the fact that the post is a promotional post and not a selection post. The promotion has to be made after a screening through interview. But reading it cumulatively, the rule does not spell out merit to be predominantly the criteria for such screening. It does not say that the best or the most meritorious has to be promoted. The rule clearly says that unfit persons have to be eliminated. Thus, the minimum suitability criteria in view of the ingredients in the rule can be adopted, but in the instant case, the appointing authority has adopted the criteria of awarding marks and then selecting the most meritorious of the candidates. This, in my opinion, is not the requirement of the rule for screening our candidates. The interview provided may require a subjective assessment of the personality test of a candidate coupled with his performance. But the candidate possessing the best appraisal cannot supersede a senior candidate who achieved the minimum level of performance for being promoted. The rule does not say that only those who are the best in performance and efficiency have to be picked and chosen on the strength of their merit alone. Had this been the intention, the rule would have been otherwise. The decision relied upon in the case of Ramkesh Supra was a matter where the rule was seniority cum merit. The word merit therefore was interpreted to mean a cumulative assessment of the performance of people of the candidate. In the intern case, the rule is seniority subject to the elimination of unfit. The case of petitioner is that in response to a notice issued to him under Section 3 of the UP Control of Gundas Act 1970, the petitioner submitted his reply after considering the reply of the petitioner as also the evidence adduced by him. The district magistrate discharged the notice after holding that the petitioner does not appear to have the characteristics of Gunda as defined under the Act. By the said order, bail bonds have been cancelled and sureties were discharged. However, by the same order dated 26-2011, which has been passed by the additional district magistrate Badain, a direction has been given that the petitioner shall report at the nearest police station every 15 days for the next 6 months. It is this later part of the aforesaid order dated 26-2011 by which the petitioner is agreed. The submission of the learning council for the petitioner is that the condition as has been imposed by the impugned order would have been imposed only after the petitioner was declared gunda under the provisions of the Act and not otherwise. It has been contended that since the notice has been discharged, as there was no ingredient of gunda found on such restriction, would have been imposed as has been done in the present case. A plain reading of Section 3 of the Act would go to show that it is only after being satisfied that the conditions specified in clauses A, B, C and D exist that the district magistrate can issue any direction regarding exterminate or impose any restriction with regard to the movement of the petitioner as provided under subsection 3 of Section 3 of the Act. What we find in the present case is that on the basis of evidence adduced by the petitioner, a clear finding has been recorded in the impugned order itself that there is no evidence to show that the petitioner is gunda and that the notice issued has been withdrawn as no case has been made out against him. On the issue of the power of the Deputy Registrar to decide membership, Dr. L.P. Mishra Learning Council for the Appellants could not dispute the legal position that such a power is available to the Deputy Registrar under Section 4-B of the Society's Registration Act 1860, as applicable in the state of UP. In our opinion, also the Deputy Registrar has failed to exercise his authority in this regard on the most important issue, which ought to have been gone into for holding of any press elections. Further, the fact that the previous elections set up by Vijay Narayan Mishra would not be recognized and press elections deserved to be held was accepted by the faction of Vijay Narayan Mishra, including the appellant who was sworn to be a member of the general body, as depicted by Vijay Narayan Mishra. The appellant also did not question the authority of the Deputy Registrar to hold the press elections. In such a situation, if the Deputy Registrar was to hold press elections, and if objections had been filed against the membership, again before him and before holding of the elections on 9-1-2013, then the Deputy Registrar was under an obligation to have decided the issue of membership. It is apparent from the objection raised by the respondent number 2 at every stage that he had been contesting the very electoral college of 24 members of the Deputy Registrar, indicating it to be the fake list which was not adjudicated upon considering the objections of the respondent number 1 in the order dated 6-8-2013. Third Learning Council for the parties and after perusal of the record, we find that respondent number 1 was appointed in the institution on the post of clerk in the United States on consolidated monthly salary. The appointment was made for a period of 1 year of probation. Respondent number 1 was appointed on an application moved by him on 15-7-1983. It is apparent from the appointment letter dated 29-8-1983 that the post in question was not advertised nor any selection committee was constituted for appointment. Responding number one, Rakesh Kumar Gupta was appointed body management on the application given by him, as there were no rules for appointment on the post of clerk in the institution.